So, ladies and gentlemen, dear students, it's my great pleasure that I can say a few words at the beginning of this lecture. And I think this is a day when I like to be a dean, because we can welcome here at the Law Faculty Professor Koen Lennerts, who is the president of the European Court of Justice. And we are very pleased that it's, in fact, for the second time that he can come to the law faculty to meet our students and to discuss with our students and professors. So I think that to have a lecture on European law with him, this is, I think, an excellent opportunity this term. Unfortunately, I think we cannot promise it every year, but we can record it and say that it's an historical moment for our teaching of European law. I would like also to add one personal comment, because I had the opportunity to meet with Professor Lennerts 2 years ago, before he went to the summer school organized by Common Law Society. And yesterday he remembered it well, and he said that he had a very good and fruitful discussion with our students in Krkonoše Mountains, and he was good to mention it. It was very pleasant to hear it as a dean. But I would like to thank also Common Law Society, which organized both possibilities, not only the summer school, but also today's lecture. It's Lord Slynn commemorative lecture, so it's also good to mention the name of Lord Slynn, who had also a great affection to Prague and to this faculty. So I think then it's an excellent combination to have Professor Lennerts here for the Lord Slynn lecture. The third small remark is concerning the theme, because I think that the theme is really very important and very interesting. And I think that to discuss the role of European law and migration, especially when we witness what the migration crisis changed here in Central Europe, how it changed discussions, how it changed the actual politics, I think it's very good to return back to the analysis of things like migration from also academic point of view, and to see it sine ira and studio. And I'm really looking forward to hear today's lecture. So thank you very much for coming, and I hope that you will feel here like at home.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to welcome you all here on behalf of the Common Law Society. I would like to briefly introduce the lecture itself. The Lord Slynn Memorial Lecture is held in memory of Lord Gordon Slynn, who visited our faculty in 1998 and delivered his speech. Since then, we held this lecture annually, and we try to invite people that specialize in EU law or the international law. Since then, we invited E.G. Sharpston and Sasha Brechel, for example. Last year, it was Christopher Weida, also from the ECJ. And this year, we have the pleasure to invite Koen Lennerts, who's the president of the same institution. And I would like to ask my colleague to deliver some personal experience with Koen Lennerts before we start the lecture.
Hello, everyone. Before giving the word to our honorable guest, let me just briefly introduce him, and let me do so from a personal perspective. My name is Jan Exner. I'm a PhD candidate, and I teach EU law at this faculty. And I know Koen Lennerts as a great judge, as a great professor, and as a great person. He's the president of the European Court of Justice, but he is also the president of the whole institution of the Court of Justice of the European Union. And reading his judgment is something extraordinary, which I recommend not only to my students, but to all of you. I also know Koen Lenaerts as a great professor. He teaches EU law not only in the Catholic University of Leuven, but he gives lectures yesterday all around the world, which are great and which I really recommend to listen to. But I also know Koen Lenaerts as a great person. I had the opportunity to meet with him 2 years ago when he came to Prague and then to Krkonoše Mountains to teach at our summer school. It was a great experience, and I really admired him that in his free time, he talked to students and he discussed with them EU law over a beer on the terrace in the mountains, and this is why I truly admire him. Today's lecture, which Koen Lenaerts will deliver, will tackle quite a recent and interesting topic of the refugee crisis and of the European Court of Justice perspective on this crisis. Mr. Lenaerts, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jan, for that nice introduction. Thank you, Marketa. Thank you, Dean. I'm very happy to be here today in this magnificent city of Prague to deliver this year's Lord Slynn Memorial Lecture. I had the pleasure of making the acquaintance of Lord Slynn back in the mid-1980s, when he was the British Advocate General and I was a young referendaire, legal secretary, that is, working in the chambers of Judge René Joliet, the then Belgian judge of the European Court of Justice. I met again Lord Slynn when I returned to Luxembourg in 1989. This time we had both changed our respective judicial functions. Lord Slynn became the second British judge to the ECJ, while I was one of the 12 judges appointed to the then recently created Court of First Instance, now the General Court of the European Union. On a personal note, allow me to say that every time I had the opportunity to engage in a discussion with Lord Slynn, I was always impressed by his formidable intellect, impressive legal reasoning, and unbreakable commitment to the rule of law. Over his 11 years of service at the ECJ, his work contributed enormously to the prestige, legitimacy, and authority of the Court of Justice. I'm happy to know that the Slynn Foundation carries on the memory of Lord Slynn's firm belief in the law as a means of leaving a better society for the next generation, in particular by providing links between the English legal system, that was his perspective, and the legal systems in the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. And I congratulate the Board of Trustees of the Slynn Foundation for that work. I also congratulate the Common Law Society of this very faculty, Pravitska Fakulta, for its work with the Slynn Foundation. I've decided to talk about EU law on asylum for two main reasons. First of all, because after Lord Slynn left the ECJ, he became a law lord in the House of Lords, now the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom, from 1992 till 2002. At the House of Lords, he participated in a number of landmark rulings on asylum law. And second, because the refugee crisis has been in the spotlight for quite some years now and has had a significant political and legal impact in the European Union and in its member states alike. I will not have to tell you that this is also the case in the Czech Republic, but rest assured, also in my native Belgium, especially in the Flemish part of Belgium, where the terms of the debate are not all that different politically and in the media from what they are here in the Czech Republic. So this is not a matter of East against West or anything else. It is simply something with which the EU and all its member states have to come to terms. In my view, EU policy on asylum is governed by two often conflicting dimensions. On the one hand, in order to create an area of freedom, security, and justice, that is an area without internal frontiers, the Schengen area, and with common external borders, EU policy on asylum must contribute to strengthening the controls on the external borders of the Union, so that asylum is not used as a means of circumventing the rules on entry into the Union. Put differently, the control of migration flows dimension of EU policy on asylum aims to offer protection only to those who genuinely deserve it. So the first component I identify is protecting the external borders of the Union so that only those really deserving international protection, because the conditions are fulfilled, come in, and not all the others who might sort of come in with the flow without being entitled to such protection. So that is the border, external border control dimension. But on the other hand, that is the second dimension, possibly at first sight a little bit contradictory, but possibly not, we will see. EU policy on asylum must ensure that the European Union is seriously committed to respecting the standards set out by international law, in particular by the 1951 Geneva Convention and the 1967 Protocol relating to the status of refugees. From the standpoint of international law, asylum does not focus on state border control, but on granting effective protection to applicants qualifying to receive it. That leads to the fundamental rights dimension of EU asylum policy, inspired by these international legal instruments, but also recognized by the EU legal order itself, in particular by Article 18 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, which recognizes asylum as a right vested in individuals. It is not for the ECJ to find the right balance between these two competing dimensions of EU asylum policy, that is, on the one hand, controlling the external borders against illegal immigration, on the other hand, ensuring effectiveness of protection for those who really deserve it under the applicable international conditions and standards. The role of the Court of Justice is not to be confused with the role of the political process. It is for the EU political process to strike the right balance between these two policy dimensions. The role of the Court of Justice, then, is limited to that of a constitutional check on the political process. This means, first, that it must make sure, the Court of Justice must make sure, that the balance struck by the political process complies with EU primary law. In particular, EU policy choices must not encroach upon the competences retained by the member states, nor may the choices made by the political process of the Union constitute an unjustified limitation on the exercise of rights recognized by the Charter, including for today's purposes Article 18, that is the right to asylum, when the conditions are fulfilled. Second, the ECJ must limit itself to saying what the law is, without changing that law. The ECJ must not cross the dividing line between law and politics, especially in cases such as those brought about by the refugee crisis, where extra legal considerations carry enormous weight. In order to highlight the role that the Court of Justice has played in the refugee crisis, I would like to divide my lecture in three parts. First, I shall argue that the ECJ, and you have understood ECJ stands for European Court of Justice, I say this for the ear, that the ECJ interprets all measures adopted in the context of what is technically called the Common European Asylum System. That's the term of art. For all the legislation of the Union, all the policy choices of the Union enacted in normative instruments, it's the Common European Asylum System. So all the measures adopted in the context of the Common European Asylum System must comply with Article 4 of the Charter, a provision that enshrines the prohibition against inhuman or degrading treatment. In the second part, I shall examine the way in which the case law of the ECJ has evolved so as to be in keeping with the changes brought about by the adoption of the Dublin III regulation that concern judicial protection of applicants for international protection. The ECJ thereby defers to the choices made by the EU legislator insofar as they comply with EU primary law. And third, I shall explain that the principle of solidarity and fair sharing of responsibility between the member states is a principle that governs EU asylum policy as a whole. It applies both to the basic EU acts that are essential components of the Common European Asylum System, and also to acts that are specifically tailored to counter emergency situations. Before moving on to the first part of the lecture, I would like to point out that all the cases which I will be discussing today concern the Dublin system. And that is because it is that system that has been put under pressure as a result of the refugee crisis. For those non-specialists, the Dublin system is in short the system indicating which of the 28 member states is the responsible member state for dealing with an asylum application and for organizing the reception conditions for asylum seekers. So it's really a mechanism of division of responsibilities between the member states. Let's move on to the first part now, and that is the relationship between Article 4 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, that is protection against inhuman or degrading treatment, and EU asylum law. One of the essential components of the Common European Asylum System is Regulation number 604/2013, which I will henceforth refer to under its common name, which is the Dublin III regulation. Why Dublin III? Because it's the third revision of the Dublin system. First, there was the Dublin Convention 20 years ago, then the first regulation, which is the Dublin II regulation, because it was the second system of Dublin, the division of these responsibilities, and the Dublin III is a revision of Dublin II, a recast of Dublin II, and the present state of the law. Chapter 3, it's all threes here, Chapter 3 of that Dublin III regulation contains a list of hierarchical criteria that determine the member state responsible for examining the application for international protection and organizing the conditions of reception of asylum seekers. Where the member state in which the applicant is present is not the member state responsible in accordance with these criteria, the applicant is in principle to be transferred to the member state responsible. And you see why this is a piece of EU legislation. You come in from an external place into a member state. But the internal borders are open, so you travel through to whatever member state of your liking. There you ask for asylum. That member state will say, am I the responsible member state under the criteria of Dublin? If not, we send him or her back to the member state responsible. As the refugee crisis has shown, the criterion that applies most in practice, that is the criterion for designating the responsible member state, the criterion that applies most in practice is that of the so-called irregular crossing. That's a term of art, hence the quotation marks. The irregular crossing of a member state's external border. I read, where an applicant, that's the text of the criterion, where an applicant for international protection has irregularly crossed the border into a member state by land, sea or air, having come from a third country, the member state thus entered shall be responsible for examining the application for international protection. So when the Dublin regulation was adopted, it was simply the idea, the member state, which is in fact first line responsible for guarding the external border, should be responsibilized to deal with all the asylum applications of those who have crossed the border. And if they did so irregularly, they should normally have been kept out. But they were let in, so it's almost sub-understood that that member state did not do entirely what it should have done, so therefore it should bear the consequences of that. It's a member state responsible. And the idea is that at the border, more or less, they could select those who are worthy and those who are not. That was when Dublin was adopted. However, that's very good if you have a dripping in occasionally of people crossing the external borders. But what to do when you have a massive inflow where it is materially impossible to do whatever practical selection it be at that external border, where the basic premise, in other words, of the Dublin system is no longer there. So where a massive inflow of applicants for international protection enters the European continent through some points of entry, which are given by geography, basically, the application of the irregular crossing criterion has the inevitable effect of putting the asylum system of some member states under enormous pressure, because practically they can't make the sorting out which they are in principle expecting to do. This is the case, as we all know, of Greece and Italy, where the vast majority of refugees and migrants first arrive in the European Union. In Greece, with a view to the Western Balkan route, in Italy, over the Mediterranean, from the Maghreb countries in Northern Africa. For example, in 2008 and 2009, the Office of the UN High Commissioner for Refugees pointed out that Greece suffered from serious shortcomings in the asylum procedure and in the reception conditions of asylum seekers, and urged the European states participating in the Dublin system to refrain from sending applicants for international protection to Greece. Now you will say, well, that's a problem, because if Greece is the member state responsible, as you just explained, and the member state in which the application is made, let's now say Belgium or Ireland or whatever, they should then, complying with Dublin, send them back, and they're now asked not to do so. So is that sort of a suspension of Dublin? The answer, of course, is no, because what people often forget is that there is, in the Dublin regulation, a so-called sovereignty clause, which is now laid down in Article 3, Paragraph 2, allowing each member state to decide itself. In other words, since Dublin is a sharing of responsibilities, a burden sharing basically, a member state can always say, I'll do it myself, and I'm not overburdening the already overburdened system. And that is exactly what the Court of Justice itself noted in 2010. Court of Justice was confronted with two cases, one coming from the UK, one coming from Ireland. I'm referring to the NS case. And the court found that in 2010, Greece was the point of entry in the European Union of 90%, 2010, of 90% of illegal immigrants. With the refugee crisis of 2015, that pressure even intensified, putting the Greek asylum system at the verge of collapsing, which in turn adversely affected the living conditions of asylum seekers in this member state. According to the European Commission, in 2015, close to 857,000 people transited through Greece. In 2016, after the deal with Turkey, that is, nearly 172,000 people arrived in Greece by sea alone. National asylum systems that suffer from systemic deficiencies may give rise to inhuman or degrading treatment of applicants for international protection, a treatment that is prohibited by Article 4 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. Logically, then, the question is whether a member state that suffers from such systemic deficiencies may, in application of the irregular crossing criterion, still be considered the member state responsible, so that the applicant for international protection must be transferred to that member state. The Court of Justice replied in the negative to that question. In joint cases, as I said, NS and others, decided in 2011 under the Dublin II regulation. In the most important passage of that judgment, which merits quotation in full, the ECJ held that, I quote, the member states, including the national courts, may not transfer an asylum seeker to the member state responsible within the meaning of the Dublin II regulation, where they cannot be unaware that systemic deficiencies in the asylum procedure and in the reception conditions of asylum seekers in that member state amount to substantial grounds for believing that the asylum seeker would face a real risk of being subjected to inhuman or degrading treatment within the meaning of Article 4 of the Charter. To make it very clear, the member state responsible no longer is when it suffers systemic deficiencies because of this massive inflow, where it can no longer fulfill the premise underlying the Dublin system to sort people out at the external border of the common space, then the other member states must help to avoid inhuman and degrading treatment of these asylum seekers. So not only did the Court of Justice say in the 2011 judgment, in which I've been sitting at the time, that they must not transfer, no, the court said they may not transfer, because transferring would lead to a breach of the Charter. And of course here, member states are implementing union law, it's all union law, so under Article 51, first paragraph of the Charter, the member states have to comply with Article 4 of the Charter, protection against inhuman and degrading treatment. So the ECJ ruled that a member state where the asylum seeker is present, in the case at hand it was the UK and Ireland, as I already said, must proceed to examine the other hierarchical criteria listed in Chapter 3 of the Dublin 3 regulation, so as to determine the member state responsible, provided that the determination does not take an unreasonable length of time, which could worsen the situation of the asylum seeker. If the determination is excessively lengthy, the member state where the asylum seeker is present must examine his or her application under the so-called sovereignty clause, the clause I refer to. And in practice, that is what it comes down to. If the member state where the asylum seeker is present and asks for asylum cannot send to the member state of first irregular crossing because of the systemic deficiencies in that member state, it will very rarely happen that there is another of the criteria which applies, which would still indicate another member state in the almost all of the cases covered by that hypothesis. It's the member state where the asylum seeker happens to be present, which must make use of the sovereignty clause. The may make use becomes a must make use. Why? It's in order to comply with Article 4 of the Charter. After the NS judgment was delivered, some scholars have criticized the fact that that judgment did not cover violations of fundamental rights which are not the result of systemic deficiencies in the asylum procedure and the reception conditions in a member state. In the view of these scholars, the principle of mutual trust as applied in NS was not wholly compatible with the system of fundamental rights protection set out in the European Convention on Human Rights, as interpreted by the European Court of Human Rights in the 2014 Tarakel judgment. The Tarakel case concerned the transfer of an Afghan family from Switzerland to Italy. And you should know that Switzerland, although not a member state of the European Union, is participating on the basis of bilateral agreements, both in the Schengen area and in the Dublin system. The European Court of Human Rights observed that in Italy, a significant number of asylum seekers, that could include the Tarakel family, were facing the possibility of being left without accommodation or accommodated in overcrowded facilities without any privacy or even in insalubrious or violent conditions. Since families with children were in a particularly vulnerable situation, their placement in such facilities would amount to a violation of Article 3, ECHR, a provision that corresponds to Article 4 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. Before proceeding to the transfer of the Tarakel family, Swiss authorities should therefore have carried out a thorough and individualized examination, the Strasbourg Court says, that discarded any risks of inhuman or degrading treatment, notably by obtaining assurances from their Italian counterparts that reception facilities would be suitable for small children. The Tarakel family was a family with 6 children, several of whom were still at a very low age, and that the family would be kept together. So authors said, well, the Court of Justice in Luxembourg in the NS judgment of December 2011, it only uses the rather high-level threshold of a collapse altogether, systemic deficiency, a deficiency of the system as a whole in the member state responsible before the mutual trust in the systems is being stopped and you can no longer transfer asylum seekers. Whereas Strasbourg protects fundamental rights better and cares less about mutual trust and really asks an in-depth, thorough, individualized examination of the situation of that particular asylum seeker and his or her family. In my view, the perceived contradiction between the two judgments, and often academic writers, they live from discovering sort of fields of tension and possible conflicts and who will then have the last word and that sort of questions. It's very much on the minds. But actually, judicial practice is very different. And I'm speaking now as a judge more than as an academic. It's very simple. In the NS case, it is the referring courts, the High Court in Dublin and the Court of Appeal in London, they said, well, the system has totally collapsed. And the word systemic deficiency is not a word invented by the Court of Justice. We work together with the national courts. It was actually the Court of Appeal in London said that this was a systemic deficiency so enormous that it could no longer be conceived that these asylum seekers be transferred to the member state responsible being Greece. So we said to the national court, well, if you find such a systemic deficiency to exist, of course you cannot transfer. You must deal with the asylum application yourself. By that, our court has not limited whatever it be to solely systemic deficiencies. When a next case comes up, a Tarakel case comes up in our court, and where there is evidence in the national court that this family cannot properly be taken care of in the member state normally responsible, would that not be a systemic deficiency for the category of families with many children, many of whom in small age? Of course it would. So one does not exclude the other, but the court is proceeding on a case-by-case basis. Like Cass Sunstein, professor at the Harvard Law School, said in a famous Harvard Law Review article, one case at a time. And that's appropriate to mention that here because this is really common law society. This is a common law method of working. And I read my good friend Christopher Vaida's speech here exactly a year ago, and he emphasized that as well. A court proceeds case by case, of course, always with a view to have make it sense more globally, more systemically altogether, but on a case-by-case basis. So let it be clear, and I'm on public record in my writings about it. I argued it in an article in the Common Market Law Review last June 2017, about mutual trust and fundamental rights protection, that there is absolutely no contradiction between NS and Tarakel. The bottom line is, whenever there is in the transfer of an asylum seeker from the member state where the asylum seeker is present to the member state responsible, whenever there is in the member state responsible a risk for inhuman or degrading treatment, whatever its cause be in that particular case, the sovereignty clause must be activated. It's no longer a possibility, it's an obligation. An obligation which flows from the Charter of Fundamental Rights itself. And of course, you find further evidence for that, and this is only by a side way that I'm saying, in the famous Aranyosi and Calderaro judgment, where the court said something similar, that in the framework of a European arrest warrant case, Mr. Aranyosi, a Hungarian national, and Mr. Calderaru, a Romanian national, could not be transferred by the Oberlandesgericht Bremen to respectively the Hungarian and the Romanian prison system when there were no sufficient individualized guarantees that the conditions of imprisonment would be such that they do not constitute a breach of Article 4 of the Charter, that is a breach of the prohibition against inhuman or degrading treatment. A further case to which I draw your attention as a last move on this first part, that is the crucial importance of Article 4, the protection against inhuman and degrading treatment, is the CK judgment handed down in 2017, so it's only a year old. The court there was confronted with a case concerning the transfer of Mrs. C.K., who is a Syrian national, her partner, and her baby. And the case concerned the transfer from Slovenia to Croatia. Why Croatia? Because it was the member state of irregular crossing. And that was because they had come over Greece, but they had left the territory of Greece into third states, notably Serbia, and from Serbia into Croatia, and from Croatia into Slovenia. So Croatia was now the member state of first entry in which the external border crossing took place. Now she should normally be transferred to Croatia. In Croatia, there is absolutely no overburdening of the asylum system. And this was not claimed. So Slovenia asks under the mechanism of Dublin III to Croatia to take Miss C.K., her partner and her baby, back. And Croatia answers within a matter of days, of course, they came in here, all right, send them to us, we accept this. So the mechanism worked quite all right. However, Miss C.K. was diagnosed with very serious health problems after having given birth. That's also why the case is anonymized. Huh? So she's diagnosed with postpartum depression. Depression postnatal. I don't know how you say that exactly. That's a very serious condition, implying a suicide risk. And any change in the practical circumstances was dangerous, even for her life. She was, of course, inseparable from the baby. And the partner who had to care for both the mother and the baby. So our court said that the transfer was not possible as long as the medical condition objectively diagnosed, so not sort of a pretext or an excuse, but something very serious with expertise, counter-expertise, and solid evidence, which here the referring court stated as being true evidence, right? Our court said that is a case similar to NS in the sense that Article 4 did constitute an obstacle to the transfer, inhuman or degrading treatment. So there, it's not even the conditions in the member state responsible, in this example, Croatia, but it is the very physical fact of transferring, which is against Article 4. Our court said in a mostly individualized case, so if there was still a doubt about conflict between NS and Tarakel, this case has definitively dispelled any possible conflict, because here the individualized analysis which our court requires is even totally separated from the conditions in the member state normally responsible. It's really the transfer operation all by itself in the individualized context. And the court said that then Slovenia was to make use of the sovereignty clause and to deal with the application for asylum. As it turned out, big tribute to our Slovenian colleagues, judges and administrations, the court ruled, of course, that Slovenia was the competent member state, and after analysis of the file, they granted asylum to the lady, to the partner, and to the baby. That's sort of for part one of my lecture, because I think that is the most important, that I emphasize you, asylum seekers, applicants for international protection, are human beings like you and me who live in circumstances they have not chosen for their lives. We're all very happy to have been born in this part of the world and not in Syria or anywhere else. And our court, even under pressure, even under political circumstances which may be adverse in many contexts, the court will not waver to its commitment to fundamental rights, and in particular to the very first listed rights, the right to life, the protection against slavery, the protection against inhuman and degrading treatment. That is a cornerstone principle on which the European Union is founded, on which all the member states of the European Union must be founded. Think about the Copenhagen criteria. It's democracy, rule of law, fundamental rights, and there is no more fundamental right than the ones I just listed. So that is also here the case in the context of the tackling of the refugee crisis. And now come to the second part, and that is a part which deals with something different but important as well. That is the effective judicial protection in favor of applicants for international protection, effective judicial protection in the against decisions applying the Dublin system. You should know that applicants for international protection have a keen interest in that it be one member state or another member state. You may say, well, all the member states more or less must do the same, and that's right. The substantive conditions and the procedural conditions have been largely unified in the common European asylum system. But of course, there may be several reasons why one wants to live in one country in terms of economic conditions, social conditions, family ties, persons whom one knows who have come in there before, etc., etc. Now, it is the European Union legislator, and I emphasize this, while adopting in 2013, that's not that long ago, 2 years actually before the major refugee crisis, the Dublin III regulation was adopted. And one of the major objectives of that regulation, so that's not the Court of Justice, it's the Council of the European Union and the European Parliament in the ordinary legislative procedure, co-decision, they have taken the decision to enhance the involvement of applicants for international protection in the process of determining the member state responsible. So the applicant has an active role to play, is actively involved in the determination of the member state responsible. One of the ways in doing that is to broaden the scope of judicial remedy available against a transfer decision. You should know that under the regime of the Dublin II regulation, the Court of Justice had severely limited the possibilities to challenge the transfer decisions. You may be aware of the Abdullahi judgment of 2013 precisely. And in that judgment, the court had said the asylum seeker is only admissible for challenging a transfer decision in the context we just discussed. That is when the risk is there, the risk threatens that the asylum seeker will be transferred to a member state where he or she will incur inhuman or degrading treatment, Article 4 of the Charter. So the court said, interpreting Dublin II as a whole, that is the whole system of the Dublin II regulation, the court said, well, this is basically a regulation setting out the criteria for dividing responsibilities to deal with asylum applications between member states. And if one member state requests another member state to take charge of an asylum seeker, and the other member state accepts that responsibility, everything is finished. Because all member states are in principle to apply the same substantive conditions, to respect the same procedural requirements, so there is no forum shopping for asylum seekers. They must accept that it be the member state, and that's a matter of agreement between the member states, more or less. That was the state of the law under Abdullahi, with the sole limit of Article 4 of the Charter, which should, of course, be judicially reviewable. That's what we just discussed. However, The legislator changed in the Dublin III, that is, changed from Dublin II to Dublin III, changed the Dublin system in a very, very important way, saying, well, in fact, these principles cannot be applied, that is, the criteria for designation of the asylum seekers, for designation, excuse me, of the member state responsible to deal with the asylum applications, the different criteria, they cannot really be applied correctly if the asylum seeker is not implied in the process. For instance, to know the member state of irregular first crossing of external border, you need evidence. You need to know how the journey took place. You need many things. Or another criterion says the member state in which the asylum seeker once got a visa. And that then holds for a number of months, except when he left again that member state and then re-entered, etc. So it's very technical. So you need somehow to be able to count on the collaboration with the asylum seeker to make these criteria work. Then the authors of the Dublin III regulation said, well, if we want to make this improvement to foster the effectiveness of the Dublin system by involving the asylum seekers in the process in order to get all the necessary information, then they should also have a judicial protection more broadly against a wrong application of the criteria altogether, not just the one protecting against inhuman and degrading treatment, but against a mistaken application of the criteria altogether. So, as conclusion on this, I can say the EU legislator had decided to involve the applicants for international protection in the process of determining the member state responsible by introducing or enhancing various rights of participation, such as an interview in the administrative process, the possibility to file documentation, etc. And thereafter, to enhance the possibility to bring a case in order to have a judge control the correct application of the criteria. The court, therefore, in the two related cases, Geselbach and Karim, Grand Chamber cases of 2016, only 3 years after Abdullahi, said that the possibilities for applicants to ask judicial review of the application of all the criteria had now to be accepted. And the court said so on the basis of the different choice made by the legislator. The court said that otherwise the rights to be informed and to provide information, that is rights which with Dublin III for the first time the applicants for asylum enjoy, these rights would be largely devoid of practical effects if they're not accompanied by a right to challenge the incorrect application of the criteria, all of the criteria listed in Dublin III regulation. In the Geselbach case, this meant that the asylum seeker was entitled to bring an appeal against a decision adopted by the Dutch authorities ordering his transfer to France on the ground that the criterion relating to the grant of a visa, you see, this is another criterion now than the one of first entry, set out in Article 12 of the regulation had been misapplied. Similarly, in the related Karim case, this meant that the asylum seeker had the right to challenge a decision adopted by the Swedish authorities, ordering his transfer to Slovenia this time, on the ground that, since he had left the territory of the member states for more than 3 months before making a new application, Slovenia's obligation to take charge as the member state in which the first asylum application was made had ceased to exist. So you see, we are here dealing with other criteria than the criterion of first entry, which is mainly, statistically speaking, the relevant criteria, but not exclusively. So if, for instance, you got a tourist visa for a particular member state, even after the expiration of that visa, it will still be the member state responsible, except if you have left the territory of the member states altogether for a period of more than 3 months. But you see immediately, all of this is factual circumstances, which must be verified and for which you need the collaboration of the asylum seeker. So when the asylum seeker makes such an argument, saying, I was away for 7 months, and he adduces evidence, and the administration says, that evidence is bogus. You construed it, we don't believe it. Yeah, obviously, when an administrative authority takes such a decision, you need a court, right? I mean, this would shock any lawyer that an administration could dismiss the evidence which you are entitled to adduce in the administrative process and say, we don't take that into account, we send you back anyway to, in this example, Slovenia, in the other case to France, we dismiss your evidence. No judicial review. That's not possible. Now, in the Dublin II regulation, that problem did not arise because the asylum seeker was not entitled to adduce evidence in the administrative process in the first place. It was a strictly inter-member state mechanism where they basically, also politically, agreed on who would do what. And maybe we will return to such a system. But it is not the present system. So this shows that the court is really sticking to the choices made by the legislator. When the legislator in 2013 has decided to involve the applicants for international protection in the process of designating the member state responsible for dealing with the asylum application and for organizing the reception condition of asylum seekers, then it is quite obviously also the court to give effect to that and to provide for the judicial review corresponding to that choice made by the legislator. In AS decided in 2017, the ECJ expanded the Geiselbach and Karim line of case law by holding that applicants for international protection can also challenge the misapplication of the irregular crossing criterion laid down in the Dublin III regulation. In so doing, the ECJ held that the rationale underpinning the judgments in Geiselbach and Karim does not distinguish between the various criteria laid down in Chapter 3 of that regulation. That rationale applied mutatis mutandis to the case at hand. Accordingly, as EU law currently stands, applicants for international protection may challenge a transfer decision that, in their view, misapplies any of the criteria laid down in Chapter 3 of regulation, Dublin III regulation. Now, so far, in the second part, I've spoken about the substantive criteria of Chapter 3 of the Dublin III regulation, and those are indeed the most important ones. However, again, you see how case law develops one case at a time. There is a second aspect to this apportionment or division of responsibilities between member states in the treatment of asylum applications and organizing the reception conditions for asylum seekers. And that is the remedies against authorities that fail to comply with time limits. You heard me say it a bit earlier. The determination of the member state responsible must be made quickly. because that is only to decide the competent forum, so to speak. But then the administrative process, possibly followed by a judicial review process, on the substantive grant or refusal of asylum protection or subsidiary protection, which is something similar, as you know, must still follow. So this first stage, it's admissibility stage, if you want, we would say in procedural terms, the admissibility stage, must of course go very quickly. So last year, in a sort of tir groupé, as they say in French, sort of all shots in the same line, all the time limits which are provided in the Dublin III system were suddenly problematic in the member states. Why? Because the time limits are there to shift responsibility to the member state where the asylum seeker is present, when the time limits for putting into effect the Chapter 3 criteria of the Dublin III regulation are not respected. So you should see this in general. You have an asylum seeker suddenly popping up here in the Czech Republic. And you analyze this and you say the competent authority should be Belgium, because there he once got a visa. And it certainly expired, but then he traveled around a bit everywhere. He never left the European Union, so it's Belgium. All right. But to find out for the Czech authorities in this hypothetical example that it is Belgium, you have to respect all the time limits. To ask Belgium to take over the asylum seeker. Time limit. You transgress it, you get stuck with the asylum seeker. Sorry that I'm saying it a little bit bluntly. You become the member state responsible. Or you ask Belgium to take him over and Belgium says, yes, I'm responsible, I recognize it. But then you sort of lose sight of the person and you don't actually enforce that decision. The person continues to wander around. After a while, you become the state responsible. I mean, this is the law as it is on the books. Now, a number of cases, E.S., Mengesteep, and Shiri, the Court of Justice was called upon to determine the extent to which transfer decisions may be challenged on the ground that public authorities have failed to meet the relevant time limits. To stay in my hypothetical example, so that you understand me very clearly, suppose after 2 years the Czech Republic discovers, hey, this man whom Belgium was ready to take over as the responsible member state, he still is wandering around in Brno. They catch him and they transfer him to Belgium anyway, after 2 years. And then this man says, you can't do anymore. It's beyond the time limit of the regulation. He goes to the administrative court to ask judicial review to challenge the time limits. So the question arose, in all these cases, what is the status of the asylum seeker, him or herself, that is the applicant for international protection, as it is technically called, what is the legal position of the applicant for international protection in case of breach of one of the strict time limits set in the regulation? Does that shift the responsibility to the member state which transgressed the time limits? One. And two, is the applicant for international protection entitled to judicial review of the decision transferring him or her anyway in violation of that, of these time limits? That's the background of these cases. So to explain it a bit more technically, in addition to the criteria laid down in Chapter 3, the Dublin III regulation contains rules that provide for the transfer of responsibility for examining applications where national authorities fail to comply with the time limit set out in the regulation. For example, where a person makes an application for international protection in the member state where he or she is present, and that member state considers that another member state is responsible for examining the application. That's my example. Member state where the applicant is present is the Czech Republic, in my hypothetical example. Czech Republic considers that another member state is responsible, in my example, Belgium, because they once gave a tourist visa, right? That's Article 12 of the Dublin III regulation. Then, the first member state where the asylum seeker is present must request the second member state, the one allegedly responsible, to take charge of that person. The request to take charge is to take place within 3 months. 3 months, it's very quick, huh? Of the date on which the application was made. That time limit is even reduced to 2 months in the case of a so-called Eurodac hit. Eurodac is a database for registering the fingerprints of asylum seekers whenever they cross external borders. A failure to comply with such time limits shifts the responsibility to the member state where the application is made. That's in the text of the regulation. So in my example, if the Czech Republic is not within 3 months, or even within 2 months when there is a Eurodac hit, asking Belgium to take charge, the Czech Republic is officially, under Dublin III, the member state responsible. Of course, in the context of the refugee crisis, where member states such as Germany and Austria received hundreds of thousands of applications for asylum in a relatively short period of time, the importance of meeting the relevant time limits is paramount. A slow reaction of the member state where the application is lodged may entail taking responsibility for examining a significant number of applications that would not have been under the responsibility of that member state had its authorities acted on time. So you see the problem when I'm taking an invented hypothetical case between the Czech Republic and the Kingdom of Belgium. That's easy to say, well, why would they transgress the 3 months or the 2 months even? There are a few numbers, yes, but in Germany, via Schaffendas, there came almost 1 million people in 2015 and 16. So then, for all of them to sort out which is the member state responsible within 3 months was next to impossible. And the Germans did not even try to do so. They simply accepted that they could not meet these time limits, and that in the huge, huge majority of these cases, making use of the sovereignty clause also, they would do it themselves. Wir schaffen das, we do it. Which, by the way, is in that sense remarkable, that they did not try to re-export to the other member states. But that was, of course, the reason why many German commentators say Dublin no longer is applicable. Well, Dublin was applicable, but as a practical matter, the German administrations could not meet the time limits within 3 months, and therefore they became even officially the member state responsible, because it had shifted from the in principle responsible member state under Chapter 3 to Germany because of transgression of the time limits. Now, in the Mengistip case, two fundamental questions arose. First, whether applicants, as I said already, for international protection could challenge a transfer decision on the ground that national authorities had failed to make the request to take charge on time. So practically, if the German authorities asked out of the 3 months to another member state to take charge anyway, and the other member state says, well, I know it's beyond 3 months, but the situation was so exceptional, I will lend you a helping hand, send him anyway. I'm no longer obliged to take him, but I'll do it in a spirit of solidarity. Whatever people think, it still happens between member states, in spite of all the political tensions. But now the question is this applicant entitled to say, I have now a right no longer to be transferred to Slovenia, Croatia, Poland, or whatever. I want to stay in Germany and be dealt with there. In the procedure in Mengistip, the United Kingdom and the Commission urged the Court of Justice to limit the Geselbach and Karim case law just mentioned, that is the possibility to have judicial review of the correct application of the Chapter 3 criterion, and to say that those criteria could be the subject of judicial review, but not the time limits, because they are only procedural. The Court of Justice took a different view. The Court of Justice said that there was no distinction between the substantive criteria for apportionment of responsibility and the procedural criteria, since the regulation itself says that in case of transgression of the time limits, the responsibility shifts to the member state where the applicant is present. We construed the regulation, much to the disliking, I must say, of Germany, UK, and other Western member states, we construed it nevertheless to the effect that a transgression of time limit is a transgression of time limit, and it entails the consequences attached to it by the legislator of the Union. In Dublin 3, it says expressly that transgressing the 3 months, respectively the 2 months, when there is a Eurodac hit, makes the responsibility shift to the member state where the applicant is present. So that is what the Court of Justice said. And the court added, as to the second point, that the fact that another member state, in the spirit of solidarity, I said, after 5, 6, 7 months, would still be ready as the substantively responsible member state to take over the applicant, doesn't change anything. It is the right of the asylum seeker, beyond the time limit, to be dealt with in the responsible member state, which is now the member state in which he or she is present. A second case is the Shiri case. In the Shiri case, the Court of Justice examined the consequences that flow from a failure of the requesting member state to transfer the applicant within the 6 month time limit. That is my second part of the hypothetical example. Eh? I said Czech Republic, Belgium. Czech Republic within the 3 months or the 2 months, if there is a Eurodac hit, asked Belgium to take charge. Belgium accepts. And then during 6 months, after that acceptance, the Czech Republic, it's hypothetical, eh? Doesn't do anything. Beyond 6 months, same thing. Dublin 3 regulation says expressis verbis, the responsibility shifts to the requesting member state, in spite of the acceptance by the requested member state. So here again, the question was, what is the effect for an asylum seeker? Does he have a subjective right? Is there judicial review? And you can already now foretell what the answer will be. Drawing on its findings in Mengistip, the Court of Justice ruled that a failure to comply with the 6 month time limit entails the automatic transfer of responsibility to the requesting member state. And that is, just like in the Mengistip case, regardless of whether the member state responsible is still ready to take over the person or not, just like in the previous example. So a very same thing. The last example in this rubric, and it's an important one, is the 2017 AS case. The question there arose where, I mean, the AS case in which the court held, that starts from there, that where an appeal with suspensive effect has been lodged against the transfer decision, the 6 month time limit to carry out a transfer does not start to run until a final decision on that appeal is reached. That is important because, as I told you, the transfer decision can now be the object of judicial review for all the substantive criteria, as well as for the time limits within which the decision to transfer is to be taken. That is the request to the other member state, the acceptance of the request. Then the decision is taken to transfer the person. But that decision, adversely affecting the interest of the person not willing to be transferred, is up to judicial review. It's of course clear that a 6 months period for carrying out the transfer materially can only start to run after the definitive failure, so to speak, of the judicial review. So that's a very important element. Now, a few conclusions on these three cases. Despite the fact that the questions referred in Mengesteep, Shiri, and AS are highly technical, one may nevertheless draw three direct constitutional implications from those judgments that relate to the relationship between the European Court of Justice and the EU legislator, as well as to the role that the Court of Justice is called upon to play in the refugee crisis more generally. First of all, the ECJ strives to interpret the Dublin III regulation in keeping with the objectives pursued by the EU legislator, that sought to provide applicants for international protection with effective and complete judicial protection. This meant in Mengesteep rejecting the distinction between substantive and procedural rules that transfer the responsibility for examining applications. This also meant that compliance with the time limits prescribed by the Dublin III regulation is tantamount to respecting the procedural guarantees conferred upon the applicants for international protection. That is why the fact that the requested member state is willing to take charge is not decisive. Second, those judgments are respectful of the fact that when adopting the Dublin III regulation, the EU legislator sought a policy shift that would enhance the fundamental rights dimension of the EU asylum law. When compared to its predecessor, the Dublin II regulation, the Dublin III regulation is closer to the fundamental rights dimension of EU asylum policy. Third and last, the fact that those three cases found their way up to the Court of Justice as a result of a massive inflow of applicants for international protection had no bearing on the rationale of the ECJ. As I stated in the order granting the application of the expedited procedure in Mengesteep, the ECJ was aware of the fact that in the context of the refugee crisis, its interpretation of the Dublin III regulation would have an enormous impact on the Austrian asylum system or the German asylum system, given that thousands of applicants for international protection were in a situation similar to that of the applicants in the main proceedings. That extreme circumstance justified the application of the expedited procedure so as to provide the referring court with an answer to novel and complex issues as soon as possible. So we decided very quickly. However, that same extreme circumstance did not authorize the ECJ to bend the rules so as to ease the pressure suffered by the asylum system of the requesting member states, Austria and Germany, to the detriment of the asylum system of the requested member states, or vice versa. The refugee crisis was not used by the ECJ as a justification to depart from the rules laid down in the Dublin III regulation, in particular by lowering the effective judicial protection of applicants for international protection. As I will explain in the next and last part, those judgments show that while it is for the EU political institutions to adopt emergency measures, it would be contrary to the rule of law for the ECJ itself to adopt such emergency interpretation that would be at odds with the wording, the scheme, and the purpose of the Dublin III regulation. And that brings me indeed to the third and last part of this lecture, relating to the principle of solidarity and fair sharing of responsibility between the member states. The principle of solidarity and fair sharing of responsibility between the member states, enshrined in Article 80 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, governs EU asylum policy and its implementation, including its financial implications. This means, in essence, that all acts adopted in the context of the common European asylum system must be in keeping with that principle of solidarity. Since that principle governs EU asylum law as a whole, it applies regardless of whether the EU act in question is an essential component of the common European asylum system, such as the Dublin III regulation, or rather a provisional measure that is specifically tailored to tackle a sudden inflow of nationals of third countries, such as Council Decision 2015/1601, that sought to help Italy and Greece deal with the sudden massive inflow of migrants that took place in the summer of 2015. I would like to illustrate this point by looking at the Jafari case, as well as the joint cases Slovakia and Hungary against Council, both decided, as you know, last year. In the Jafari case, the ECJ was asked to interpret the concept of irregular crossing within the meaning of the Dublin III regulation. In the Slovakia and Hungary case, as you all know, these two member states challenged the validity of the just mentioned Council Decision 2015/1601. In 2015 and 2016, there was a massive inflow of applicants for international protection who sought to make their way towards Western Europe via the so-called Western Balkan route. This was actually what the applicants in Jafari did. In 2015, two sisters, called the Jafari sisters, left Afghanistan, each one with her child. And they traveled to Iran, Turkey, Greece, the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, and Serbia, so into Croatia, an external border of the EU. Croatian authorities organized transport for them by bus to the Slovenian border. Slovenian border is an external Schengen border. In Slovenia, they were given police documents stating that their final destination was, for one of them, Germany, and for the other, Austria. Wir schaffen das. That was the context. Upon arrival in Austria, the Jafari sisters lodged applications on their own behalf and on behalf of their children for international protection in Austria. In application of the criterion of irregular crossing set out in the Dublin III regulation, the Austrian authorities took the view that the member state responsible for examining their applications was Croatia, since the Jafari sisters and their children had crossed the border between Serbia and Croatia irregularly. Austrian authorities noted that in any event, Greece could not be the member state responsible, because they had first gone through Greece, as that member state suffered from systemic deficiencies. So Greece was probably not the member state responsible anyway, because normally for the irregular crossing criterion, you take the last contact between a third country and the country and the member state of the Union, which was Serbia, Croatia. But the Austrian administration said, even if it were Greece, the country of first crossing, because they first came into Greece and then left the Union again and came in through Croatia, Greece is still suffering from systemic deficiencies and could not possibly be the member state responsible. So accordingly, the Austrian authorities ordered the transfer of the Jafari sisters and their children to Croatia. The Croatian authorities were ready to take them over. So this is a case where you have an agreement between the requesting member state and the requested member state. However, the Jafari sisters challenged nevertheless the decision, arguing that they had not crossed the border between Serbia and Croatia irregularly because their transfer had been tolerated by the Croatian authorities. You must know that the pressure between the Serbian and the Croatian border, it was 10,000 and 10,000 of people day after day flowing in over that border. So in line with human dignity, they could not shoot on these people. Huh? No one suggested it. So there was a physical impossibility to stop them, so they rolled over. So the Croatian authorities sort of waved them through. What in German is very beautifully said, durchfinken. They were sort of waved through. They got even police protection to go through Croatia, also to see that they would not be lost along the way. To Slovenia, they did the same, and so to Austria. But of course, the Jafari sisters were not interested at all, neither in Croatia nor in Slovenia. They wanted to be in Austria and possibly even in Germany for one of them. So they do everything now to be able to stay in Austria. And they say, well, our crossing there in Croatia was not irregular because it was tolerated and even helped by the Croatian authorities. And the fact that the Croatians are ready to take us back, that doesn't mean anything. We have the right. So what to do? The Court of Justice found that no visa within the meaning of the Dublin III regulation had been issued to the applicants in the main proceedings, and that therefore the concept of irregular crossing of an external border by a national of a third country needing to be in the possession of a valid visa when crossing such a border is an irregular crossing. So in other words, the concept of irregular crossing was defined in an unwavering way, the crossing of a border without fulfilling the conditions imposed by the legislation applicable in the member state in question. And although Croatia is not part of the Schengen zone yet, the Schengen area, it has of course both national legislation and some EU rules which made it absolutely clear that this Afghan nationals were in need of a visa to have a regular lawful crossing. So the court kept to that, and it found that the Jafari sisters had irregularly crossed and that therefore Croatia was indeed the competent member state. And Croatia had well done to accept taking them back. But here again you see there was argument made by a number of states, even Croatia in front of us, although in the individual case they complied very loyally to Dublin III by accepting the request made by Austria. Systemically, they argued, well, but we can't have hundreds of thousands coming back, all those we waved through. There the Court of Justice said, all these crossings, whether you tolerated them, whether you helped them or not, they are irregular for the purposes of the Chapter 3 Dublin 3 regulation criteria. Irregular crossing. They don't satisfy the requirements of the law. However, the other member states can only send them back when there are no systemic deficiencies. If sending back so massively would mean that the Croatian asylum system would crumble like the Greek one did, they could no longer send back. They can always use the sovereignty clause, and they must respect the time limits. So there was no big risk of sending back. You must always see the Dublin system as a whole, and it all makes sense in an interrelated fashion. That brings me to the second and last case for this lecture, and that is precisely what the Council did by establishing the relocation mechanism for applicants for international protection that gave rise to the cases brought by Slovakia and Hungary, supported by Poland, not by the Czech Republic, against Council. You know, I was just arguing that the ruling of the ECJ in the Jafari case demonstrates that even in times of a refugee crisis, it is not for the ECJ to bend the rules. There is no such thing as emergency interpretation. However, it's a matter of separation of powers, principle of separation of powers, that the political authorities are to deal with the necessary adaptations of the system as it exists in the legislation. That's why it is for the political institutions to change the existing rules if the need to do so is felt in order to sufficiently cope with emergency situations. As you all know, the Council has done that by adopting this decision 2015/1601, based on Article 78, third paragraph TFEU, which is a specific provision for dealing with such emergency situations. That decision of the Council constitutes a provisional measure, temporary, that aims to relieve the significant pressure on the Greek and Italian asylum systems and provides for the compulsory relocation from Italy and Greece to other EU member states over a period of 2 years, now expired, of 120,000 persons in clear need of international protection by establishing a system of quotas per member state. So the Council, in a way, derogated temporarily and based on this extreme crisis situation, that is the huge numbers of which we now spoke repeatedly, directly based on the exceptional clause of Article 78, paragraph 3 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, to adopt a provisional, temporary, limited measure to reapportion 120,000 asylum seekers over all the member states, except, of course, Greece and Italy. Now, Slovakia and Hungary, who had been outvoted because it has been adopted under the qualified majority voting system in the Council, which is expressly authorized under Article 78, third paragraph of the TFEU, they brought an annulment action, which is their full right to do so, to the Court of Justice. And after the change of government in Poland, because Poland had voted in favor of this decision in the Council, but then Kaczynski came to power, and then they changed their attitude, so they joined on the side of the applicants against the Council to ask the annulment of that temporary measure. As you know, the application was dismissed and the legality was upheld. But for the purposes of this lecture and also working towards my conclusion, it is important to refer to the 10th plea, there were many pleas, of Hungary in the case. In dismissing that plea, the Court of Justice had to interpret the principle of solidarity and fair sharing of responsibility. Hungary had indeed argued that a contested decision brought about a disproportionate burden on its asylum system. Now, in order to understand Hungary's arguments, I would like to say very briefly that initially Hungary was also one of the member states which should have benefited from the relocation system, because they also had a quite important influx. But then it appeared during the summer of 2015, and more towards September of 15, that in fact all these asylum seekers, they went through Hungary, like through Croatia, and no one stayed there. And the Hungarians, they were fair enough, it must be said, to signal that to the council, and they said, well, actually we are no longer in any emergency situation, so we should not benefit of it. So the council said, well, we should now consider you to also take a quotum. And the quotum is not very many people, eh? It's 2,000 people or something, so a relatively small quotum. Now Hungary said, no, that would go too far. And they said, together with Poland, that the burden on them was disproportionate because they were, I quote, virtually ethnically homogeneous, and the population is different from a cultural and linguistic point of view from the migrants to be relocated on the territory. So that is basically an argument saying these people are so different from what we are that this would put a disproportionate burden on the society. Of course, if we say that, that can potentially hold true for any of our member states. I can tell you that if you go through the Flemish villages in Belgium, that you will not see many veiled Muslimas either. It's a matter of, you know, but it's comprehensible, it's understandable that the argument be made. But there, of course, the Court of Justice said that such arguments were not enough to consider the principle of proportionality, that is, the burden on Hungary or Poland, to be disproportionate, that it was strictly in tune with the economic level of existence in the countries, because there had been many criteria objectively used to determine the numbers of the different quota, and that, of course, these criteria had as such not been attacked, that they were proportionate, and the court said taking into account religious or ethnic differences would of course be against the fundamental rights, like we all know, because that would amount to religious or racial discrimination prohibited by Article 21 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights and could not be taken into account. So to conclude, I think you see by that that the Court of Justice has the role to make the balance of a system work. It is not the Court of Justice making the policy choices at base. If the Council of the European Union in September 2015 had not adopted this emergency regulation based on Article 78, third paragraph of the TFEU, the Court of Justice would never stepped in. So it is at base a political decision, like the whole common European asylum system. Our task consists in keeping all the checks and balances inside the political choices made alive, that is to enforce these rules, to interpret them uniformly, but in compliance with the Charter of Fundamental Rights. Article 4, protection against degrading and inhuman or degrading treatment, the right to effective judicial protection, the right not to be discriminated against on racial or religious grounds, because those rights are reflecting the triangle on which the European Union is founded, also in a difficult political context like the refugee crisis. It's a union based on democracy, the rule of law, fundamental rights protection, and based on the solidarity and the mutual respect between all the states and peoples of Europe living in a common space without internal frontiers and with common external borders. Those are the parameters within which The court upholds the law, like it is its task to do so, in the context of Article 19 of the Treaty on European Union. So I hope to have been able to transmit a little bit of the fundamental spirit in which we developed that case law, and to have motivated you, many students here present, for the study of European Union law as a sort of common law of Europe, a law which is Czech law, which is Flemish law, which is Belgian law, which is Portuguese law, which is Danish law, a law which we have in common, which we can change and make develop in common, and which we will also, as lawyers, uphold in common. Thank you very much. It was my pleasure to be here.
On behalf of the Common Law Society, I would like to thank you all for coming. I would like to express my special thanks to our honorable guest, President Lenoir, for attending this lecture, and have a nice day.